found a certain thing, a certain feeling, that lets two people express themselves as they feel. Let your love flow inside of you. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid, baby.
Good afternoon to all of you. A very warm welcome to the CESAR Young Scientist Award ceremony. My name is Peter Hecker. I'm member of the CESAR Scientific Committee and chairman of the award board. So it's a real pleasure to have you all here and to see who is the winner in the today's award. The competition was launched in 2012, so 10 years ago. So we are celebrating this year the 10th issue of the award, which is quite a remarkable anniversary. The CESAR Young Scientist Award aims to recognize young scientists who have demonstrated excellence in air traffic management and further aviation-related research fields. It's very important to recognize that it is not only limited to achievements from within the CESAR program, but also beyond, allowing for a wider range of topics and areas. The award provides researchers starting out in their career with an opportunity for further professional development, and it showcases the potential of young talents to formulate fresh ideas and solutions to the challenges facing ATM and aviation. This year, we have observed an increased number of applications from all over Europe, which is a remarkable number. And we are very happy that many of the applications have been developed in a truly international and European context. Like the years before, the PhD candidates were able to apply who had defended their thesis within the last 18 months. And this year, we even have something new. A new instrument has been added to provide more visibility to the different profiles of young scientists across Europe. And this new instrument will be introduced by Rita Shomogi, a colleague in the scientific committee and also a member of the award board. Please, Rita.
Hello, thank you very much for handing me over. My name is Rita Shomogi, as Peter has already mentioned, and I also very warmly welcome you to this award ceremony. And indeed, we have a new category. It's the student category, meaning, as its name implies, that all students could also apply who have finished their bachelor's, master's degree, or who are in the course of compiling their PhDs, finishing their PhD studies. We have reviewed these applications as well, and I need to highlight at this point that these applications were all judged on the level what can be expected from a given thesis. So meaning that the bachelor's will be judged on the bachelor's basis, or on the basis of what you can expect from a bachelor's degree, whereas a master's on a master's level and an ongoing PhD on an ongoing PhD level. This is very important. Regarding the price for the winner, it's 1,500 euros, but all the runners-ups will receive 500 euros for vouchers. So already it's also very good for them to be with us here. And the next slide will already show the names of the three runner-ups in alphabetical order. Let's see the names of these. And already congratulations for the nominees whom we have here in our circle now today. And I would like to ask them to please present very shortly your topic. It will be exciting to know what you have been working with and working on. And in an alphabetical order, I would first like to ask Chen to prepare for her presentation. You will each have 5 minutes, so please stick to the time. I will also remind you if you would override this time. So I would remind at the end, and I would like to ask now Chen to present her work.
Okay, thank you. So let me share the presentation. Do I need to put my cameras on?
Not for the time being, but later on we would really love to see your face.
Okay, great.
If you're comfortable with turning on, it's okay. It's up to
you. Okay, then good afternoon, everyone. My name is Chen. The topic discussed. Okay. Wait, ask me to open my. Okay. But anyway. So I put, let me start again. Good afternoon, my name is Chen. And the topic discussed in my thesis was characterization of potential conflicts and resolution patterns. The work was supervised by my supervisors from the Research Center CRIDA and the Politecnica University of Madrid, both in Spain. This is the index of my presentation. Due to the limited time, we will focus on the results only, and which are the general and the resolution observations. The thesis was an exploratory research that aims to find the patterns of potential conflict resolution strategies in the tactical phase, especially the use of directs and vectors. The analysis was focused on a Spanish sector, Barcelona Central, with the traffic data of 18 days of August 2019. The whole methodology has three main steps, which are trajectory prediction, potential conflict detection, and the resolution analysis. In this presentation, we have included only four observations from the analysis. First of all, by comparing the length of the planned trajectory and the radar track within the sector, all the flights were divided in three categories, less, equal, and more. And less means that the tracks was shorter than the planned routes, which implied the use of directs. And the more category was caused mainly by the use of vectors. By doing the categorization, we found that a low traffic level, which the Mr. Jonathan Heaston called opportunity mode, the directs were frequently issued. Even in the figure, it seems that the curve of more category prevails. Actually, they are direct as well. But the tracks were larger in this case because of the irregular shape of the sector. As the traffic level increases, the flights tend to be more adhered to the ATS route. And the transition from one mode to the other happened when the traffic level was nearly full. Secondly, many directs were issued before the flight's entry. And for each flow, it seems that the direct clearances were issued within a particular time interval before the crossing point with other flows. And this time interval is also different depending on the target waypoint. Regarding the resolution, we focused our analysis on two pair of flows with the largest number of interactions. And in this pair in particular, we found a typical resolution that the controller applies, which is a combination of a vector followed by a direct, to send one of the flights to the tail of the other one. And finally, the level change clearances seems to be used more frequently when there are other flights rather than when apart from the interacting pair are geographically near the crossing point. The work had many limitations, and the most restricted one was the lack of information related to the real resolution. We know that a direct way issued, but we don't know in the first place the intention of that clearance. And for future analysis, the predictors and the conflict detection models have to be further improved to enable the detection of a more accurate sample of analysis. And we need to identify those clearances that were actual resolution strategies. And we will include in our analysis or to analyze in more detail other strategies, such as the use of level clearances and the speed control. The main references of the work were the dissertations of Christian Verdon Gallego, Eduardo Gonzalez, and Jonathan Histon. Thank you very much for your attention.
I thank you very much for presenting your work and keeping the time limit. Thank you very much. And I expect you back at the end of the three presentations for the announcement. Okay, and now I would like to ask our second nominee in alphabetical order. If I remember correctly, it will be Jan Ebler. Indeed. Hello, Jan. Can you hear me?
Hello, yes.
Nice to meet you. Nice to see you.
Nice to meet you too.
The floor is yours, sir. Please also stick to the 5 minutes limit.
Yes, I will share my screen.
Thank you.
All right. Hello, everyone. I'm very grateful to present to you today my PhD thesis on airline ground operations, in which I aim for optimizing schedule recovery under uncertainty. The working hypothesis of my PhD thesis is that ATFM and airlines have different flight prioritization paradigms. In fact, for ATFM, each flight is regarded as equal when they impose sector capacity regulations for safety purposes. While on the other side, for airlines, each flight is unique, given that they have to respect constrained airport resources, daily changing aircraft rotations, crew pairings, and passenger itineraries. As a consequence, the airline decision making is poorly understood from the ATFM perspective, and the aircraft turnaround as the connecting element between aircraft rotations, crew pairings, and passenger itineraries is the major contributor to primary and reactionary delays in Europe. In order to bridge this gap between both paradigms, my dissertation proposes a decision support model for airline operations control, which considers all resource constraint at an airline hub airport. For potential disruptions, the model integrates a wide range of recovery options and can perform trade-off decisions to identify which recovery option should be applied to which aircraft and which flight should be delayed because it has the least negative consequences for the downstream network. In this course, the first research question I asked myself was how much airline network performance can be recovered at what costs when all recovery options are integrated. The answer to these questions is not so obvious, as this recovery solution is very sensitive to the type, scope, and intensity of a disturbance. And of course, this emphasizes the need for a sophisticated decision support system, as I propose in my dissertation. What I can say is that for disturbances with low and medium delay for the airline, these are typically recovered with stand changes and rapid passenger transfers, and as well with arrival slot swapping. On the other side, if you have disturbances which induce high delay to the airline, these are best recovered with passenger rebookings, and on top of arrival slot swapping, also departure slot swapping. Of course, although all these recovery options are nice, it's sometimes inevitable to have a delay on some aircraft. And so my second research question was, how can flight-specific downstream constraints be considered for optimal schedule recovery in case of delay? And of course, we are all aware of the reference delay cost functions that have been developed by the University of Westminster. However, these are not intended for context-specific prioritization of flights, as two flights which would be operated with the same aircraft type would also have the same delay cost function. So I took a step backwards and formulated flight-specific cost functions which respect downstream constraints of a particular aircraft rotation. And further on, I also considered that a departure delay may not directly propagate into the same amount of arrival delay at the destination airport, such that the block time uncertainties in between need to be considered. When I include these uncertainties, the resulting stochastic cost functions look like this. And I find that an optimization based on stochastic cost functions requires less passenger rebookings for the airline at the hub airport, and it also increases the flexibility. Finally, and coming back to the difference in paradigms for flight prioritization between airlines and ATFM, I asked how airline internal flight priorities can be coordinated confidentially with ATFM. This question relates very much to the user-driven prioritization process, UDPP, such that I analyzed how the airline can communicate its preferred slot allocation without revealing any sensitive details about the underlying cost functions. I find that the only information that ATFM requires from an airline is the definition of one optimal delay margin per flight. So even the most complex ATFM slot swaps can be reproduced by only two values per flight, the scheduled in-block time or off-block time, and the optimal delay margin as it is calculated by my model. In this context, I also studied what would be the added value of any additional slots for the airline. And I find that my model can evaluate the efficiency of potential slot trades between airlines, depending on all tactical constraints. With this, I would like to thank you for your attention and also once again for this nomination. And if you're interested in any further details, please have a look into the papers and articles that are related to my PhD project.
Thank you very much, Jan, for also the keeping the time limit and also for the very colorful and concise presentation of your research and your results. Thank you. And then the next presentation comes from Raul. As far as I know, it's my technical colleagues and up to them to start the presentation.
To present my research, and I will mainly focus on the past 4 years during which I did my PhD in the Technical University of Catalonia in Barcelona. So I'll start with a brief introduction to give a bit of context to my research. So basically, in the past few years, air transportation has been increasing a lot. It's true that this COVID situation might have slowed down a bit this upward trend, but still a lot of an increase of traffic is projected for the future. So this growth leads to also a growth of the global economy, which is good, but also it leads to higher environmental impact and ATC workload, which is bad. So these bad effects are even worse in terminal maneuvering areas where high levels of congestion, noise and emissions can be found. So there's clearly a need for research into methods in order to achieve greener air transportation. In this context, continuous descent operations allow aircraft to fly continuous descent where engines are at idle and no speed brakes are used. So this is different from conventional descents where aircraft do some steps while descending, which increases both the fuel consumption and the noise effect over populated areas. So the problem with CDOs is that they are different for each aircraft. They are optimized to each aircraft, so each single aircraft will fly a different CDO. This means a reduction of the vertical and temporal predictability of the operation, which means an increase of the ATC workload. In such a situation, ATCs usually apply some separation buffers between aircraft which ultimately leads to capacity reduction. So in the end, CDOs in terminal maneuvering areas are rarely applied except for off-peak hours. And some of the reasons are due to a strategic constraints in arrival charts. And also at a tactical level, ADCs tend to give some open loop instructions or radar vectoring, such as altitude assignments, or speed adjustments, or path stretching in order to sequence the aircraft. The problem with this instruction is that the duration of them is not known by the flight crew, so the flight management system on board cannot compute the optimal descent trajectory. So aircraft cannot fly CDOs in such a situation. So there's clearly a need to be able to sequence aircraft in a way that they can fly continuous descent operations subject to control time of arrivals. So Cesar and also NextGen have identified some ways to improve this, and basically my research is focusing on that. So I'm trying to improve the algorithms involving ground automation, also trying to propose technical enablers to apply a trajectory-based operations paradigm. Also, I work on traffic synchronization and trying to propose routes that adapt dynamically to the arrival traffic. So my objectives so far, it's been basically, I started with an efficiency assessment in TMA where I compared historical flight data with energy neutral CDOs, where engines are at idle and speed brakes are not used. And also I proposed several methods to schedule arrival traffic in TMA. I proposed a set of technical enablers in the form of novel methodologies and different concepts of operations, also considering energy neutral CDOs. And for that purpose, I developed a trajectory optimization framework, both for generating trajectories and also to schedule and test, to schedule aircraft and test these new algorithms. So some key findings of my research. Regarding fuel efficiency assessment, I compared historical flight data obtained from OpenSky, which is an ADS-B database, with respect to CDOs. There were many variations throughout the month. Also, I assessed the effect of weather. Here you can see a plot of the comparison of the fuel consumption throughout the month. Also, I used I scaled arrival traffic in a trombone procedure. As you can see, currently aircraft are not following these trombone procedures exactly. You know, like there's a lot of dispersion here. What we propose is to negotiate an RTA, a required time of arrival, and a shortcut of the trombone before the top of descent, so that the aircraft know the trajectory that they are going to follow and the FMS can compute the optimum descent trajectory. On the other hand, we also proposed this setup here, where we have a dynamic trajectories area where trajectories are generated in a dynamic way depending on the amount of traffic and assuming that all of them are flying neutral CDOs. So we're moving away from this star paradigm, and well, this is what we proposed in the vertical plane. So next steps, I have many ideas to further improve the results obtained during the PhD, and currently and I'm working on several research projects here at UBC, some Cesar projects and also some Clean Sky projects. For instance, Safe and Sea here, the Clean Sky project is focusing on the generation of emergency trajectories. So that would be all. Thank you. It was short, but well, I hope you liked it. Thanks.
Thank you, Jan, for the presentation as well. And now comes the exciting part, the announcement of the third, second, and first person, please turn on your cameras, all the three of you who are nominated. This is supposed to be like the Academy Award, you know, in the US, so that we can see your faces. I just check. Yes, it's my time and my honor to announce from the third prize, starting with the third prize. We will going to see who is going to get this third place now. Congratulations, Jan. It was a very exciting work. We really enjoyed reading through your material. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. And now the second place is going to become obvious, which of course means that the first place is going to be obvious as well. So let us see who is in the second place now. Congratulations, Raul.
Thank you very much.
Also very detailed material you submitted to the committee. Thank you very much. And now the first place goes to... Congratulations, Chan. It was our pleasure to read all through your material and all through your documents. It was a really impressive in the level that you did, what investigations you did. And now I invite you to stay with us a couple of minutes more. We will just now take the so-called family photo. So if we could be there in person and if this could be a live event, of course we would have a photo together. But as this is not possible, I just would like to ask you to stay with your camera on, and probably I also ask Peter, please, Peter, turn on your camera, so we can all have a photo together, you know, like this, and say cheese. I hope that the technical people are actually paying attention, and they are making a family photo of this.
Pictures are made.
Okay. Great, okay, thank you. So this much about the family photo and about the announcement of the winners. And there is one more remark, which is very important for me to make. Some of you are close to closing your PhDs, so it's an ongoing PhD with which you have applied, and we strongly encourage you to keep an eye in the future for the next opportunities to apply. In the next, if there will be such, we really hope to see these to try once again in the next level, if you are ready to do that. And Jan, Chen, Raul, thank you very much once again, and for all those students who submitted their applications. And now it's my time to hand back to Peter.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yes, if you would like to say some words, Chen, because as you just talked into the microphone, you still have a couple of minutes if you would like to say some words on your prize.
Thank you very much. I think I don't have anything else to say. Thank you.
Okay, you are welcome. And then the floor is back to Peter then. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rita, for the handing over. And now we come to the PhD category. As I said before, candidates were eligible who had defended their PhD thesis within the last 18 months. And we received a very good number of applications, and it was a pleasure to read through the thesis and to see what has been done. Excellent scientific works have been presented. And we have selected three runner-ups, and now we are going to introduce them in an alphabetical order, and I'm going to read all three names and the affiliations. So let's see, the three persons are, in alphabetical order, Gabriel Jerry from École Nationale de l'Aviation Civile from Toulouse, better known as ENAC, Isabel Metz from TU Delft, the Faculty of Aerospace Engineering, in collaboration with the German Aerospace Center DLR, the Institute of Flight Guidance, and Philippe Momoussou, again from ENAC in Toulouse. And now we will listen to the presentations, again in alphabetical order, and I would like to hand over to Gabriel Jerry to present what the content of the thesis is. Please, Gabriel.
Good afternoon, everyone. I will start sharing my screen. So I'm Gabriel Jarry, and I'm very honored and happy to be here today to present my PhD thesis entitled "The Aircraft at Speed Approach Detection Using Functional Data Analysis and Machine Learning." This PhD was directed by Daniel Delahaye and led in collaboration between the French Civil Aviation University, ENAC, and the French Civil Aviation Safety Authority. As a short introduction, I wanted to say that during the last year, we have seen a non-negligible number of incidents in accidents occurring during the landing phases. On top of it, these incidents and accidents usually presented what is called atypical approach path management and particular issues with the energy management of the aircraft. This was the starting point of the PhD thesis, with the aim of developing from ground side, from an ITC point of view, model based on historical data in order to automatically analyze and detect atypical behaviors in the energy management of the aircraft during approach and landing phases. Another objective of the PhD was the development of supervised learning model in order to assess and evaluate the performance of the aircraft using only ground data. And finally, the last objective was to extend this methodology into a real-time framework in order to give directions toward new situational awareness alerting systems. What are the outcomes of the PhD? First, we have developed a ground data-based anomaly detection methodology that uses functional principal component analysis, density estimation, and sliding windows, and that enabled the automatic detection and localization of atypical behaviors during approach and landings. We have compared these methodologies with state-of-the-art methodologies such as generative adversarial anomaly detection. And we have also worked with French airlines in order to assess the potential links with these atypical energy management and safety events monitored by the safety offices of these airlines. In particular, we have shown a strong correlation between atypical energy management and non-stabilization of the aircraft. A second outcome for this PhD was the development of supervised learning, such as recurrent neural network, in order to estimate aircraft parameter from ground side using available data, such as radar data, and to predict such parameters like the flaps and the landing gear extension, and also the engine power or the fuel flow of the aircraft. These models enable us a better understanding and analyzing the incident and the safety analysis of this event, and also could be useful in the context of environmental performance assessment. Finally, the last part of the thesis was dedicated to the extension into the real-time framework of this methodology using Dubin-SPACE, giving directions toward new situational awareness alerting system for air traffic controller, providing them potential mitigation actions, such as the extension of the lateral path, potential recovery path for the altitude profile, or even suggestion of going around. This methodology and this algorithm also has an important part in the pedagogical means in order to analyze flight event, flight incident, in order to replay them and analyze what happened during these flights. I will now finish my presentation with the research perspective around this PhD thesis. First, I deeply believe there is a huge part of potential research around reinforcement learning in order to extend this work, not only for ground side, but also for onboard, and give potential trajectory suggestion for aircraft and potential extension of the aerodynamics of the aircraft in order to recover from a typical situation. Another important research perspective is what is called AI trustworthiness. When we are talking about including in safety critical application AI methodologies, there is an important issue which will be in the future to give some explainability to these models, to give some learning assurance regarding the dataset we use to train this model, or even to merge and mix these modelization with classical physical model in order to enhance the robustness of this modelization. And finally, I wanted to highlight that this research has already some operational implementation. In December 2020, I joined the French DSNA, where I'm now working on the Acropole project, which aims at industrializing and implementing this algorithm in order to provide automatic post-operational indicators regarding the safety and the environmental performance of the aircraft. The next step for this project will start next year with an experimentation with a French airport in order to analyze and investigate the use of such kind of methodologies in a real-time framework. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Gabriel, for the presentation. It's very good to see that the content of your thesis has been implemented in an operational context and is now being really used in daily business. Next presenter is Isabel Metz, and I would like to hand over to Isabel, please.
Thank you very much, Professor Hecker. Good afternoon. It's my great pleasure and honor that I can present my PhD thesis in that session. So I dealt with bird strike prevention in my PhD and actually also in my ongoing postdoc position. Bird strikes are collisions between aircraft and birds, and they are a low altitude problem. A big majority happens very close to the ground and therefore close to the airport. Many measures have already been taken there, and they also show a lot of success. A big problem, however, is the area outside of the airport, so in the departure and approach corridors. Here we see an increasing trend of bird strikes and especially damaging bird strikes. And here, especially departures are concerned. To provide more safety in that area, the idea of my PhD was to involve air traffic controllers and pilots in the loop, so actually the parties who are responsible for the performance of the flight. The concept of my bird strike advisory system is that we use sensory information from avian radar about the bird situation at the airport, perform a risk assessment, and as long as as there is a high risk of bird strikes, aircraft are held back at takeoff. As soon as the birds have passed the critical area, aircraft are cleared for takeoff. I performed Monte Carlo fast time simulations to have a look at the feasibility of that approach. Therefore, I looked into three different scenarios. First of all, I only let run air traffic and bird traffic unimpeded to see how many collisions happen when there is no system in place. This gave me an idea about the safety potential of the approach. In a second step, I looked at the bird strike advisory system. Here, I first assumed perfect predictability of bird trajectories, and therefore the system would only have to do a collision resolution. This gave implications about the capacity loss when we stop aircraft to let birds pass. And in the first step, I actually assumed that bird trajectories are only known until the planned takeoff time of the aircraft, as it would be in reality, and then performed a risk calculations whether to delay the departure or not. So what did I find within my PhD thesis? Well, of course, the basic requirements to implement successfully a bird strike advisory system at airports is that we have limited impact on capacity. In my thesis, I could prove that the capacity impact is highly bearable even for high density airports. So a very first important step has been achieved. The predictability of bird tracks, which is required to actually only delay aircraft and when the risk is high and to really make a safety benefit, is the second important part. Here we found that the mathematical model, which I used for my PhD thesis, is not yet quite sufficient to achieve the required safety benefit. Therefore, I continue research within my postdoc, and I include ecological factors, and I use a lot of historical data and train it with artificial intelligence method in order to achieve a more sophisticated model and bring the system closer to implementation. In addition to that, I extend the scope of my research to urban air mobility operations, because these vehicles, such as air taxis, they're highly vulnerable to bird strikes. They fly low, they fly fast, and they have low certification requirements. So you see, my PhD actually was just the beginning, and there's a lot to be continued with researching. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Isabel. It was very nice following your scientific development over the past years and seeing that you achieved the PhD thesis now, and I've just learned that there's much more to come. So thank you very much for your presentation. Now we will listen to the presentation of Philippe Momousseau, again from ENAC in Toulouse. And Philippe, the stage is yours.
Thank you very much. Let me share my presentation. So thank you everyone for coming. Oh, too fast. So thank you everyone for coming, and I'm really honored to be one of the three nominees runners-up for this PhD award. So I'm gonna present a quick overview of my PhD thesis that was entitled Passengers, Customers, Actors, and Sensors of the Air Transportation System, that I did at ENAC in Toulouse under the co-supervision of Daniel Delahaye and Aude Mazzuri. So briefly how this small talk is gonna unroll is that first I'm gonna focus on the reason why we started on the passenger data side. Then we'll see some key outcomes of my PhD and then some next steps that follow from my research. So first, why focusing on passenger data? So I wanted to tackle a problem as a passenger when we say taking the plane. Is it really just taking the plane? If it were the case, you would imagine your trip like going from an airport to an airport with the plane. So, but as several studies have shown, and I think there was a panel about multimodality in this SID talks, and you as a passenger, you know that it's not just that. It's also all the part to going to the airport, going through the airport, taking the plane, going through the arrival airport, and then finally reaching your final destination. But still, if we're saying taking the plane, it would mean that the plane part should be the most important part. But during my PhD, I've come up with a model that showed that for some trips, like for example, between LAX and SFO, you would spend half of your time from your full trip in the airport of departure. So it's not just about taking the plane when you say taking the plane, and the air transportation system has to take a better approach on a better focus on passengers. And the only thing, beacon that goes from the end, first the starting point to the end point, is the passenger. That is why we had to focus on passenger data. But working with passenger data is hard because you've got two kind of data. There's the data that's passively generated, like for example, passport, ticket scans at the airport, but this data is dispersed. You can have mobile phone data, and that's really precise data, but it's proprietary data and hard to access, and even more nowadays. And then there's data actively generated by passengers that could be surveys, which is a bit time consuming and usually small scope. And recently we've got the rise of social media, and my PhD tried to see how we could extract some relevant information from social media, especially Twitter, and other also means of for passengers. So based on this, let's see what key outcomes my PhD came up with. So the key outcomes is what we can do with that passenger data. So one of the first results was that you can use it, process it, and manage to create a flight-centric real-time estimator of the air transportation system. That, for example, estimating the number of planes that are delayed, canceled at every hour at every airport in the United States. But well, that's a flight-centric approach. But passenger data also gives you access to more information about that trip. Like, for example, the experience of the passenger for the trip, which can be measured between the interactions between passengers and airlines or passengers and airports. And this measure is this way of seeing it is really useful when there's no planes flying. For example, as the COVID-19 pandemic appeared, using these tools based on passenger data, passenger generated data, I was able to propose a real-time estimation of the impact of COVID-19 on the air transportation system without having to wait for official reports. So those two points, those two estimators and those two metrics I created based on passenger data led to the creation of a website, paxradar24.com, which daily updates the metrics and the models produced. And then there's a third aspect to my PhD was to estimate the full door-to-door travel time. So as I explained in my introduction, using passenger data but merging them from various sources, you can come up with a reliable door-to-door travel time estimation, which can help you then measure several key milestones, for example, the four-hour limit to traveling intra-Europe. So the next steps was that this door-to-door model is going to be improved and continued within the ER4 number 10 project, Transit Travel Information Management for Seamless Intermodal Transport. My website is daily scrapping data and outputting the results, but I'll have to think about how to adjust models following the COVID-19 pandemic and probably propose some new passenger-centric metrics based on this evolution. And now I'm working for a company that wants to create an app that provides direct cash value for customers and passengers based on their data, because the hardest part about studying passenger data is to have good passenger data. And that's concluding my talk. Thank you for listening. And now it's time for the results. Stop sharing.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
We really enjoyed, listening to
your reading.
Now, probably it's better now.
So, yeah, now it's much better. We enjoyed reading your thesis and identifying more options and potential for using those passenger data and data from social networks. Very, very well done. Okay, now to increase even the tension, I may announce that the third and the second candidates will receive a voucher of 500 euro and the winner will receive a prize of 5,000 euro, quite an amount. And now let's see who are the third ranked, the second ranked and the first candidate. So let's have a look. Congratulations, Isabel, very well done. We enjoyed your work, so all the best and thanks a lot for the application. Now let's have a look to the second place. Congratulations, very well done. We enjoyed reading the work. And now I think it's quite obvious who is the winner, but still we want to listen to the music. Let's have a look. Congratulations, Philip, very well done. Do you want to say a few words to all the audience?
Well, I want to thank you all for awarding me this award that shows that the importance of considering air transportation system as a whole and not only the flight part. And I would also like to thank all my advisors and my PhD mate Gabriel Jarry, with which I did my full 3 years of studies. And thank you very much.
Great, thank you. Now we are going to take the family photo again. So your cameras need to be turned on. I think they all are. Now you should say something like cheesecake or whatever you use in your language. And Just smile.
Pictures are made.
Okay, and at the very end of the session, we will have two more family filters. I will explain them at that point in time. So now I may summarize. In my point of view, this Young Scientist Award has proven to be a really excellent instrument for identifying and promoting young talents and recognizing and communicating the outstanding scientific achievements in the ATN domain and beyond. And I only can say, keep your eyes open for next year's issue of the Young Scientist Award. We are very confident there will be one. And so thank you all for the applications. And we are waiting many more applications in the next year to come, and already being excited what we'll see next year on the stage. Now, before we close the session and before you all leave, there will be two more family photos. One photo will be with the winners of the two categories. So I kindly ask the two winners on the stage, and there will be a photo. Okay, and then there and then there should be a photo with all the candidates and applicants who are here in the session today. So all the six, please join the stage. And there will then be then the final one. Isabel, you may turn on your camera again. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much. And I now would like to hand over to Dirk Schaefer for summarizing the content of the technical sessions. Thank you very much again, and looking forward to meeting you in the near future again. Thank you and bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Excellent. Thank you.